I'm going to do what some piano students are taught to do before they play. That's kind of like a thank you so much because you're going to listen to me right now. Anyway, it's a way of honoring you, and I honor you for being here today. And I'm actually become increasingly excited to share this word with you. And as we were worshiping, I heard in my spirit, it's a setup in the spirit. It's a setup in the spirit this morning. Look out, it's a setup in the spirit this morning. Everything that's been going on. And it's no accident you are here. You are here. So if you want to turn in your Bibles, if you have a Bible or an iPhone program on your phone, your iPad, or your tablet, we're going to Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1. That's just about at the New Testament, but not quite. If you're looking for that Old Testament prophet, Zechariah chapter 10, verse 1. And in the NIV it says, ask rain from the Lord in the season of the spring rain, from the Lord who makes the storm clouds, and he will give them showers of rain to everyone, the vegetation in the field. And I have been looking at this passage for a year. I was drawn to it about a year ago. I can't really remember how that happened specifically. I think I was watching something on Bethel and it came up and I was intrigued by it. And I went to it on my iPad, on my Bible program. And I spoke on it last year in March a couple times at House of His Presence. And ever since that time, every time I every time I open the Bible program on my iPad, that passage has shown up, no matter what I read previously, every time I open my Bible program. And interestingly, it's stopped happening. Here I am finally releasing the word, and it stopped happening. Anyway, it's kind of been interesting, though, because of the emphasis on this passage, it's been like everything that we've been going through and learning has been through the lens of this passage, ask rain from the Lord in the season of the spring rain. And so I have given it a lot of thought, and I really believe that this has a big impact and a lot to say about where we all are right now, where the body of Christ is at, how we conduct our personal lives, and how we function even as a body corporately. And so it was like God was constantly, through this thing, inviting me into a deeper partnership with Him and a deeper understanding of His desire for people to partner together with Him. So we're going to look at the passage in a little bit of a orderly fashion, and I'm going to share with you what I think God is saying through it. And so here we go. The first thing, if you're taking notes, the first thing is ask the Lord for rain in the season of rain. What does that mean? Ask the Lord for what He's doing in the very season He's doing it. The Amplified Bible says, ask of the Lord rain in the time of the latter, or spring rain. It's the Lord who makes lightnings which usher in the rain and give men showers and grass to everyone in the field. Now, there's an interesting difference between the latter rain and what might be called the former rain, or the first rain that would come. The first rain, which would happen in October, in their culture, they would call it that, made the seed fruitful. It did what they called fructify the seed. It would make it productive or fruitful. But the latter rain swells the grain, getting it ready for harvest. Very interesting difference, because we're asking the Lord for rain in the time of the latter rain. The latter rain also is known to be much more intense than the gentle, soft rains of the October rains in their experience. The latter rains are heavier and fuller. So interesting that we would be asked to partner with God for that. And interestingly, I think very interestingly, the latter rain comes right about now. March is the key time. Could be anywhere, February, March, April, but March is right in the center of the natural time of the latter rain. Woohoo! Yeah. So, very, very interesting. Now, I think, and I thought this, and you probably think this too, that it is odd, it seems odd to ask God for the thing that he says he's doing. Doesn't that sort of seem like, why would I need to ask God for what he's already just said he's doing? I think it's because we're being instructed to partner with him. We are his agents on earth here. And he has given us authority. And he's saying, ask me, partner with me, so we'll be on heaven, on earth as it is in heaven. It's like tying in to Jesus' teaching in the Lord's Prayer. It's essentially that in an Old Testament version, you know. So I think it's very interesting that, I mean, we would be instructed to partner with him really in any season, but it is, I think, very interesting that we are here with this right now at the calendar time of year for this. And so I think there's a lot of dovetailing of setup going on here in the body for us. Yeah. And we are invited, I believe, we are invited to call in those blessings that he wants to shower on us. We are invited to partner with them. So here's the thing, guys. If we've had a promise or a word, a prophetic word from God regarding something in our lives, we should not sit idly by waiting for God to act. But we agree with him. We partner with him for heaven's purposes. We absolutely have to contend for the promises of God that he has given us. We learned this in a very striking way, actually. I'm going to bring this up now, although we'll talk about this. We, as probably just about everybody in the room knows, a year within a few, not even 2 weeks from now, picked up brand new BMW that was won. My husband won it last year. Now, we picked it up March 31st. He won that BMW, I believe, literally the first Thursday, actually won it the first Thursday of September, right after Labor Day. So whatever the math is on that on months, that seems like not very long. It had to be put together in Germany and brought across the ocean. You would not believe, and I can't go into the all the detail of contending that we had to do in the spirit when we discovered there was funny things going on in terms of, well, we didn't realize it was being held up until we found out that he was, out of 100 BMWs being given away, his was number 59, and number 99, who happened to get one in St. Catharines, had hers before Christmas. And we said to ourselves, hold on, what is happening? What's going on here? Because, you know, God did this, we didn't do anything. We didn't even enter a contest that we knew of. So anyway, I bring this out to say, and there's an incredible reason for it, which I will bring out later. Why? But we had to contend for months, every day for months, when we discovered that oh, maybe something's going on with this thing, because we've been given a prophetic word about it, about the purpose of the BMW. And it wasn't just to have another car. So we had to contend for it. So I'll just say this, that it is very important that in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, Paul says, for no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And get this, through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. That amen is very important, establishing. It's spoken by us. We come into agreement. So we have to contend and we have to agree. And this is the thing. We can know that we stand in confidence to partner with God in this agreement because it is in his character and nature to bless his people so that he can show his goodness to the world. He wants to display his goodness. He wants to display his goodness. So, one other thing before we go to the next point, and that is this. On a practical note, if you have a promise that you're waiting for fulfillment on, or a word of prophecy that you've been given, and you're looking for the fulfillment of that word, I would say in a practical note, if you are married, pray together on a regular basis regarding this. The prayer of agreement is a powerful thing. Unite together in prayer. If you are not married, but you have prophecies or promises, even promises from the Word, you believe God has said this, you're hanging on to this. Maybe it's for family to come to know the Lord or something along that line that you... There's no question it's God's will, you know. Find someone else and partner together in prayer. This is a powerful tool, and all too often we go the Lone Ranger thing, and it's very easy to get discouraged. Very easy to get discouraged. The body is meant to work together in unity, and I think it's a deeper and more powerful connection to have if we will take advantage of that, if we will realize, hang on a minute here, we need to take hold together, okay? So that's it. The first thing, then, is to ask for the very thing God has said it's the season for. Number two, it's the Lord who makes it happen. Notice in the second line, it says, it's the Lord who makes the storm clouds. He's the one who makes it happen. All your striving, just relax. It's the Lord who makes it happen. That doesn't mean we do nothing. But it is the Lord who makes it happen. Our faith is in the God of the promise, not the promise, right? Our faith is in the God of the promise. We can trust his character. Jeremiah 10:13 tells us, he makes clouds rise from the ends of the earth. Ha! I love that picture. The source of the rain of the blessing, the answer that you're looking for, can come from wherever God wills. I don't care where it is. He makes vapors form from the ends of the earth to bring the answer to you. Everywhere. The fulfillment of your promise from anywhere. He's not limited by our finite minds and ideas. We can go, oh, this can't really happen because I don't, you know, oh, that's not really possible. That's not God. He is way above that. There's no impossibility with God. All of heaven and earth are at his disposal to bring about the fulfillment for your promise, for your prophetic word, the promise he has made to you, the fulfillment of what he wants to do. Yeah. Terry Bone said when he was here a year ago, he said, our faith is our amen to the promise of God. Yeah, our faith in God is our amen to the promise of God. So that's number two, that he can do it. God does it, and he can do it any way, from any means. Number three. The passage in Zechariah tells us that it's meant for everyone. It says he gives to everyone the vegetation in the fields. Now, this sounds, okay. I think that it's very important to understand this is not for a select few people who appear to be favored. This is for everyone. The rain in the season of rain is for everyone. In fact, it's so much for everyone that even those who don't believe benefit. Wow. Wow. Rain in the season of rain is meant for everyone, believer or not. And it will be felt and seen in the natural world as well as the spiritual world. There will be evidence of it that will touch all lives. When rain falls on your life, and that starts to become evident, that blessing starts to flow, it starts to affect the people around you. You know, so it is meant for everyone. If you feel like, well, other people, you know, God sees them. They're doing this. They're doing that. He favors them. He clearly favors them. The favor of God is not something that is for one and not another. The favor of God is for everyone. Take hold of it. Don't be left out. Take hold of what he offers you. He's already holding it out to you. Take hold of it. All right, all right. That's number three. Number four. Its ultimate purpose is for fruitfulness and harvest. It says the vegetation of the field, right? It rains on the field. It's for everyone so that it will bring about a fruitful harvest. The interesting thing is this word for the vegetation is actually a word that means every kind of herb, which is really kind of neat. And I won't go into all the things to do with an herb because there's a lot of things there really. But I found it interesting that it suggests variety in the harvest, every kind of herb. You know, that variety. And I think that it is showing us how God so wants a harvest that is so varied in its scope and in its flavors, if you will, if you're looking at an herb, that it's meant to bring a harvest of fruitfulness to every area of life. You know, in the kingdom of God, and that it's supposed to infuse and influence all aspects of our lives and in the kingdom. And we've even been seeing more and more, if you think about it, more and more harvest, more fruitfulness in the arts in the kingdom of God, and the gifts of the Spirit in greater measure, more and more people functioning and working out in the gifts of the Spirit, and even in expressing the life of God in our own lives, you know. And I think that fruitfulness of harvest is meant to be there. And when we call for rain in the season of rain, this is going to be a profound effect of that. Inside and outside the church, I guess that's the thing, that God wants the fruitfulness to affect every area, that this is not just about the body of Christ, right? It is about the body of Christ, but it's about the world. It's about every area of life. It's supposed to spill over. I mean, we've been talking about this a lot. Spill over into politics. Spill over into medicine, into education, into the land itself, into families. I mean, the list goes on. Every area of life. I just believe that we've kind of made a line and said this is sacred and this is secular. But I think God looks with eyes of love on everything and looks at it all. It's all sacred to me. It's all sacred to me. Every grain of sand, you know, every part of creation is sacred to me. You know, and I think that's a powerful thing when we realize that this blessing and rain we're calling for, that rain in the season of rain, is not just about us. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. But it got such a huge scope. So those are the main points of the passage I wanted to look at. But I have some things to talk about now that we've done a little bit of an orderly look. It's the teacher in me. So anyway, but after that, I said to myself, I have some questions. I have some questions. I felt that we had to ask ourselves a couple of questions, two questions. First of all was, how do we know what season we're in? That's the good question. And the second question was simply, what season are we in? I think that's a good question too. So, here we go, to answer the first question. I believe two things, and there may be more, but two things. First of all, how do we know what season we're in? First of all, we absolutely have to know the one who makes the seasons. We have to know him. And I'm not just talking about knowing him and being right before him, surely that, but I mean we have to know him. We have to walk on a daily basis with him. We have to be in communion with him, in conversation with him. That is the first thing. There is, and we're discovering that more and more, I think, that there's no substitute for knowing God or being intimate with him. There isn't a substitute for that. It's a safety feature, really, I think. Because if we were able to do things that we think we need to do without that closeness, a lot could go wrong. An awful lot could go wrong. And if we do try, sometimes a lot goes wrong, you know. So the intimacy with him, the connection with him, that communion with him, where we express ourselves with him and he is speaking to us, where we take the time to listen, that is critical in being able to know what season we're in. Even Jesus in Scripture, he taught us that he reveals things to those who seek him, right? He reveals things to those who ask. And in Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13, he says, you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. You know, that is a way of knowing what season we're in. It is the first way. Anything else outside of that is just exterior. The connection with him is key. Key, key, key. I can't stress that enough. But I also believe one other thing with regard to knowing what season we're in, how to know. I believe also we can discover what season we're in by keeping our eyes open to the world around us. And to the kingdom of God. What's happening with the kingdom of God in a large measure? And here's the thing. We can't really expect to have a large understanding of the season we may be in if all we're focused on is our own little world. You know? If no matter how wonderful our little world may be, or how awful, no matter how much our own affairs cry out for our attention, we must not only look to them. We must look outside ourselves if we want to see what the season's all about, what's going on now. very critical. It's crucial because we can go wrong if we only look at ourselves too. It's not all about us. It isn't all about us. But we can see things, and it can show us. And I just want to say, it's not that you ignore your personal life and leave undone what should be done. I'm not saying that, but we have to look outside our own circle. Jesus, when the disciples asked him, how are we going to know when you're coming back? What did he tell them? He said, look for the signs. You'll see signs, right? And I would suggest to you today that we can look for the signs of the seasons, even in the natural world. I think it's a powerful thing. Okay, and we'll talk a little bit more. Some of these are going to dovetail together, and you'll see that in a minute, and even all that I've already gone through with the passage. We'll go on. The second question, what season are we in? I think it is safe to say clearly, we are in a season of breakthrough. And breakthroughs that we will see in numbers of ways. I was thinking about it. There have been so many prophetic words given over the last number of months, even from last year, this time on, for the body of Christ, breakthrough in the body of Christ, that even if only half of those people had actually heard from God, it would still be overwhelmingly strong message for breakthrough. There have just, it's been constant. In fact, as I was thinking about it, even as we were worshiping on that this morning, it's been like a snowball of the message of breakthrough that's been going over the last number of months since last March, I would say, just on and on and on. Prophecies of breakthrough in finances, just tons of them. Giftings, the body of Christ rising up in giftings like we have never seen. Promotions, breakthrough in salvations, just blowing wide. Breakthrough in healings and miracles. And the list goes on. The breakthrough for the body of Christ that has been prophesied. It's been crazy. So, I look at a few things, even in our own experience, and I say, So I'm going to list a few things. On our home front here, I'll use Jenny. I didn't even ask you if I could use you as an example. But she has seen, in the last number of months, incredible breakthrough in her music studio. Numbers of students, like, what did you say? How many percentage more was it? It was 750% more students. I mean, we're not talking little dribble. We're talking obvious. Yeah, one of her students has recently won the music festival. Woohoo! So that was awesome. But, you know, you appreciate that when you have been working really hard and you've been plowing ahead like you've been plowing concrete. And bam, all of a sudden there you are. You know? So this is, and it's only growing. It's only growing. It's awesome. As a church, we've been seeing more and more healings in the last number of months. More than ever. More than ever healings in the last year. More than ever in 20 years. That's amazing. So, within this season of breakthrough, I think we have a couple of things, though, elements that I think are important. One is, it's also a season of suddenlies. Yeah, and what's a suddenly? It's a quick, sudden fulfillment of promises or prophetic words. That is amazing. Everyone's like, I want a suddenly. I want that so much. Sounds like fun and so much easier. So much easier. But the thing is, I think we'll be surprised at the suddenlies that will happen. But they'll happen after you've plowed. You'll happen after you've contended. And there's a reason for that. I'm going to tell you a story of a suddenly that happened to us not very long ago. And some of you know about this, but just before Christmas, Dale was at a meeting at Jeeva's house with Peter Kumar. And Peter Kumar prophesied over Dale numbers of things with regard to the church. And one of them was that a businessman was going to come and give seed money to us for our building program, which at that moment we didn't have. That's fun, right? Anyway, I was not at this meeting, so that was a Thursday. The next day, our day off, we're sitting having coffee. I'm like, I want to hear that prophetic word. So he had it on his phone, so he plugs it into our speakers, finds it on the recording, and we're sitting listening to it, and it's at the part where it says about the businessman who's going to give money to us as seed money for our building program. We hear that. Phone rings. His phone rings. We stop the recording, and it's the businessman calling to give us seed money. That's a suddenly. That's a suddenly. It's crazy. It's crazy wonderful. Yeah. So, also connected to the season of breakthrough is what I call the season of the long shot. The long shot. The thing that's been said to be unlikely to come to pass. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Let me tell you, I get so excited about this because we have gotten to see it in the natural in a way that is unprecedented. This is fantastic. Listen to this. In the fall, the Chicago Cubs won the World Series after a 108-year drought. Okay, wow. Wow. That was kind of a long shot. Even though they were a good team, anyone would probably say, after 108 years, you know, I don't know. 108-year drought, they win. Phenomenal. Fantastic. Back here at home, the Grey Cup, the Ottawa Red Black, new name, they were the Rough Riders, they won the Grey Cup. This particular win was the biggest upset in Canadian Football League history. They are, get this should encourage some of us, they are the first team in CFL history to take first in a conference with a losing record. And they beat the team with the league best of season record. That is a long shot. They had losing record going in. They come against the team. It's like David and Goliath. They come against the team who have the top record, expected to take it all. And they won. Unbelievable. Super Bowl just happened last month, right? Now, New England Patriots were expected to win, but not like this. They were behind 28-3 with not much time to go. I don't have the detail on the minutes, but it was not long. It was crazy. They came back to win 34-28. 24 records were broken in that game. 24 records. It was the biggest comeback in Super Bowl history. Crazy. Crazy, right? Yeah. A couple other things. The BMW. That's a long shot. That's a very long shot to win a BMW in a contest you did not intentionally enter and knew nothing of. Even if you did intentionally enter, it's a long shot when you talk millions of people in it. Big long shot. One last one, and I just think of Greg and Lori, friends of Jenny and Jed's, who have just had, after 17 years of marriage, their first child. They thought that was not going to ever happen. In fact, when she went to get tested at the hospital for some problems she was having, she just told them, I'm probably menopausal. Like, you know, no way I'm pregnant. They said, well, we should probably check it out anyway just to make sure. She was pregnant. No clue. Long shot. No expectation anymore. Long shot. But God, I believe this is a season of the long shot. Look at the signs. Look at the signs. We see them in the natural. It's fantastic. Fantastic. Oh, our hearts should swell and take great, great encouragement. One more thing here. In this passage, in the Amplified Version, listen to this, I'm going to read it one more time. Ask of the Lord rain in the time of the latter or spring rain. It's the Lord who makes the lightnings, which usher in the rain and give man showers and grass to everyone in the field. I got thinking about the lightning, you know, the lightning and the storm clouds that are like a sign that it's coming. And first of all, I'd like to say this. Sometimes a storm cloud will look threatening. And we really have to look with the eyes of the Spirit at what is around us so we don't miss what God's doing. Sometimes the thing that looks kind of iffy, kind of maybe scary, sometimes it's the vehicle God's bringing the blessing in. So we want to have the eyes of the Spirit. Eyes of the Spirit. What are you doing, God? Okay? That's very, very important. But as far as the lightning goes, lightning is in the natural, a couple of powerful things. It's very obvious, and it's very powerful. Very powerful. I don't have it in my notes here, but there's an awful lot of power in a bolt of lightning. Awful lot of power in a bolt of lightning. The heat in a bolt of lightning is crazy. In fact, that's what makes the sound. But anyway, things that go on because of that. Others of you in the sciences could probably articulate it, and I will not even try. But my point is this. Is it possible that these long shot occurrences are like lightning bolts in the Spirit that precede the rain that's coming? Yeah. Signs that the season of breakthrough is upon us. Could it be that the incredible provision and upgrades that are the Lord giving things to show us his goodness? These coming just ahead of the rain which is the real wealth, the spiritual riches. And here's where it gets really important for us, I think. We need to understand that these breakthroughs that we need are far bigger than us. Far bigger than us. And that's why we have to contend. The financial breakthrough you need is not just for you. Your financial breakthrough is going to become a powerful tool in the kingdom of God. Your breakthrough in your family salvation is going to become a powerful tool in the kingdom of God, because who knows how many people are meant to be affected by the people in your family that don't know the Lord yet. The children you're waiting for. That breakthrough. Contend, because that child, those children, have a destiny that is waiting, just waiting. Who knows? They might be prime minister. Who knows? They might go across the world. Millions will hear the gospel and be saved for all eternity. Who knows? But I'll tell you what, the enemy will try to stop it. The enemy will try to stop it. God wants to bring upon us a goodness, a rain, a breakthrough that brings true riches. Is a BMW in the driveway true riches? No, not really. The true riches is what happens in lives when we get to tell the story of God's goodness, how that happened. We have testified over and over and over again about the goodness of God for everyone, his desire to bless everyone. That's true riches. In his book, The Blessed Life, and some of you will have this book, because we had it as a church for, probably 8 years ago or 6 years ago or something. If it's out there, it's worth getting. It's a little daily devotional by Robert Morris called The Blessed Life. Anyway, in it, he talks about true riches. And he says this, that true riches are words of knowledge, gifts of healing, faith, and miracles that minister to people. True riches are being able to help others who have spent their entire lives in bondage to depression or oppression experience freedom for the first time. Because true riches are souls. True riches, you see, last for eternity. This we have to have in our minds. This is not about us getting stuff or even having it easy. Easier. It's about true riches. Yes, God wants to bless his people. Yes, I believe he wants us to have a good life. He made us to enjoy life. It's not supposed to be, all work, no play here on earth. It's not supposed to be just a grind and then I'm done. It is supposed to be full of joy. That's why Jesus said, I came to give you life and life more abundantly. God does want to bring that. He wants our lives should reflect that, but to a bigger end. It's a bigger end. Your blessing, your breakthrough is to a bigger end. And he needs us as his people to get a hold of this. Why? Because when we see the bigger end, we will contend. We will contend. We will not sit idly by, because it will mean more. Even more than just me personally, I want this or I want that, or I know God has said this. Even more. It's to a bigger end. It's to an end that will be eternal in its value. Your breakthrough, whatever it may be, is to eternal value. I really want to nail this today. So, here's the thing. It really is a big deal we understand this, because the enemy will try to hinder it. He will try to hinder your breakthrough. And I believe this too, that we have to contend rather than it handed to us on a silver platter, because we will need the strength and the intimacy that is developed in this time as we contend to live in the breakthrough. We need the new level of intimacy, the new level of fellowship with him, the new level of strength, of character, of faith. We need that in ourselves to live in the thing he's going to give us, because it's that big. It's that big. If you need a healing in your emotions, God, bring it on, because you need that to live in the new breakthrough he's bringing. If you need a healing, or you need a means, you need anything, bring whatever strength. If you need a strength of faith, you need to grow in that. You need to do everything you can in stretching for that, shall I say, leaning into that growth. Because what he wants to bring you is so big. So big. He takes us from glory to glory. And I don't think that's glory to glory. I think that's glory to glory. You know, higher, higher, higher in him. So it's really important. So, oh yes, I almost forgot I have another story for you. Good thing for notes, right? Yeah, this is the last one though. 1 year, we were struck by lightning, Dale and I, when we were camping. This is quite a while ago, 24 years ago or something, along that line. No, he didn't have black hair. As we all know, lightning is attracted to conductive types of materials, like metal. And we were camping in this sort of kind of interior-ish camping. We had to canoe in. I'll just make this quick. But the sites were, they were far apart. You couldn't see each other. So it was really quite nice. But shortly after we got there, a storm started to move in. And I mean, it looked so threatening. It looked so threatening. And we'd had nothing up. And so we had put this canopy up. And I was holding this metal pole. And I'm pushing up on the canopy. And the force of the storm knocked it out of my hands. Praise God. And so it all crashed down and everything. And bam, this huge bam. And Dale had his hand on a tree. And then he didn't have his hand on the tree, but he had shoes on, so he was super happy because he felt a zap. And we're like, and then you smell this burning and you think, maybe it's me. And, you know. So anyway, we're standing there in all this. And all of a sudden, this other couple comes running through the bushes to us. And they go, we've been struck by lightning. And they were struck by lightning. I don't know how they ran. I don't know how they were not dead. They had been in there. They had been cooking. And when it started to get, you know, the storm was coming, they decide, well, we're just going to pull just picture this, in our little tent, we're just going to pull into the doorway with our stove and keep, you know, so we don't have to turn it off. We're going to do, and they had their hands on the metal pots. And it was so close, the strike was so close, like they were zapped. They had marks on their body from where it exited. It actually caused their tent pegs to fly out of the ground, just to give you a picture. Okay, so I was just reminded about this, the power of the lightning strike. And everything turned out okay. We all ended up in an ambulance together, and it was very interesting. And it's become a sort of one of those things that goes down in family folklore, you know, the call that gets made, we're okay, but we've been struck by lightning. It's a line now in our family. But anyway, lightning rods are made and put on houses to attract the lightning away from the house. I don't know how they really do it, but that's what they're designed to do. And I got thinking about that. If we want to be ones that attract the lightning of the Spirit of God, what do we need to be made of? What material is conductive material of the Spirit? Well, two things come to mind in a big way. Faith and words of agreement. Faith and words of agreement. I believe these two things in particular attract the power of God. Faith. Faith. Hebrews tells us that without faith, it's impossible to please him. Faith and words of agreement with him. What has he said? Agree. On earth as it is in heaven. On earth as it is in heaven. That we become like lightning rods of the Spirit. You know, all these long shot things that I've mentioned, at the very least, they should encourage you to keep praying, keep contending, because the lightning is coming as a sign that the rain's on its way. It's like God is saying, look, look what I can do, because nothing's impossible. You think you saw something phenomenal in some of these sports things? That's just a sign. I can do real stuff. I can do stuff that changes lives. I can do stuff that makes makes unbelievers sit up and take notice and want to know. Aha, yes. So keep partnering with God, contending for your promises, contending for your destiny. Ask for rain in the season of rain. It is breakthrough time, guys. It is breakthrough time. Ask for it. Take hold of it. So today, have you an area in your life that you would say is a long shot for success? Have you an area in your life that is a long shot for success? Maybe it's that the doctor said, you'll probably never overcome this physical problem. Maybe family history has said that you probably will never amount to anything. Any gamut of things, a long shot for success. Have you got promises from God or prophetic words that you've been given that as of yet are unfulfilled? I suspect almost everyone in this room has things like that. Whether they're promises you're hanging on to from the Word or whether they are prophetic words that someone has actually said to you and you knew God was in it because it was in your heart, you know, that you haven't seen fulfilled yet. Do you need a breakthrough in your life or in your family? I have good news for you. This is your season. I believe it with all my heart. I believe it with all my heart. This is your season. And I just want to pray over you right now. So I want you to, if any of these things apply to you, stand up. You have some part of your life that's a long shot for success in any way. You've got promises from God or prophetic words you've been given that aren't fulfilled yet. You need a breakthrough in any way in your life and family or family. Okay. Yeah. So God. Whew, yeah. It's a setup in the spirit. I believe it. What God was saying all the way through this whole morning. It's time for breakthrough. It's time for breakthrough. It's time for breakthrough. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Father God, I thank you right now. I thank you for what you're doing. And we all together, God, we collectively join our faith together. We join our faith together this morning now. That breakthrough. The rain in the season of rain right now. Yeah. The fruitfulness is varied as the God who creates it. Yes, Lord God. Yes, Lord God. Let it just come, Lord God, that breakthrough right now in Jesus' name. I first of all call out for that breakthrough, the long shot breakthrough right now in Jesus' name. Those that have been told something that would suggest that it is unlikely they would ever see come to pass, what is in their hearts come to pass, whether it's a healing, whether it is overcoming an obstacle of any sort. Right now, in the name of Jesus, in the powerful, beautiful name of Jesus, we speak in agreement with heaven for the breakthrough for each one of these in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And together right now, we contend for the promises of God for each one standing here, the promises of God, the fulfillment of words of prophecy that have been given. We contend together one more time. We together collectively say amen to the yes that is in Christ Jesus. We say amen. Let it be on earth as it is in heaven. Let it be on earth as it is in heaven. Let it be on earth as it is in heaven. Amen, 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 amen. Let it be on earth as it is in heaven. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. Yes, God. We open our eyes, God. We see the signs. Lord, let us see more, 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 more. Eyes to see, God. Eyes to see what you're doing in the Spirit in Jesus' name. Yes. Yes, God. Father, I pray for everyone in this room that needs a breakthrough in any means. God, breakthrough in finances in the name of Jesus. And we bring before you, Lord God, every prophetic word that has been uttered in agreement with heaven for the breakthrough of finances that's coming to the body of Christ. And we agree with that word right now in Jesus' name, that we will be a people marked with your abundance, Lord God, able to be used by you in the building of your kingdom. God, we come into agreement with the breakthrough of finances. God, with everyone that's in any way attached with employment, we pray breakthrough over that, breakthrough, upgrade, an elevation to ones in position. God, yeah, upgrades of position, upgrades, God, in people's incomes, Father God. Upgrades and God, creativity from heaven in the making of finances. God, that comes from you. Establish the work of our hands here in this house for each one. Establish the work of our hands, oh God. Oh God, yeah. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, because we see today, God, that this is way bigger than each one of us. Way bigger, Lord God. This is about establishing your kingdom here on earth. This is about being part of the big picture of what you're doing. This is about nations as an inheritance. This is about the nations coming. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. God, I pray for anyone who needs a breakthrough in healing today, whether it's physical, emotional, mental, breakthrough right now in Jesus' name. Breakthrough, a breaking now in Jesus' name. Yeah, the veil's been torn. The veil's been torn. Breakthrough is ours through the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus, oh God, that's already been paid for that breakthrough. For those that need breakthrough in family relationships, Father God, come. Father God, by your Spirit, breakthrough in Jesus' name. We receive it, God. We receive it. Breakthrough even, God, in salvation, family salvation. God, prodigals coming home. Breakthrough, God. We call it in the name of Jesus. Breakthrough, God. We've been contending, and we know it's your will, God. We can know without a doubt it's your will. We just declare that breakthrough in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God.